Hello, ladies and gentlemen, dear attendees of the Embedded World Conference, dear visitors, my name is Professor Sturm, and I have the chance to introduce our keynote speaker for 2018. Welcome to the opening and of the Embedded World Conference. My name, I told you this already, it's a good tradition that the well-known personalities of our industry open the conference with a keynote. We are pleased that the CTO of AMD, Mark Papermaster, sitting in front here, has a possibility to talk to us today. Mark Papermaster is Chief Technical Officer and Senior Vice President of Technology and Engineering at AMD, where he is responsible for technical leadership and product development, including system-on-chips technology, microprocessor design, I/O and memory technologies, and advanced research. With more than 35 years of engineering experience, Marx has held a variety of leadership roles leading the development of a wide range of products from microprocessors to mobile devices to high-performance servers. Prior to joining AMD in October 2011, he led Cisco Silicon Engineering Group. Here, new strategies, architectures, and technologies for silicon-based structures are developed for the switches and routers business segment. He was Senior Vice President of Apple Device Hardware Engineering and responsible for the development of iPod and iPhone hardware. He has also held a number of leadership positions at IBM, where he led the development of key microprocessors and server technologies. So please welcome Mr. Mark Papermaster. I'm so proud to have you here.
Gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Mark Papermaster, Chief Technology Officer and Senior Vice President of Technology and Engineering at AMD.
All right. Well, thank you, and it's really a pleasure to be here at Embedded World. Professor Dr. Sturm, thank you for that kind introduction. And we're very excited at AMD to have this opportunity. I was explaining to Dr. Sturm earlier that I couldn't imagine a better time for AMD to have a chance to share with you our view on the embedded products and where the opportunity lies in the industry right now. Why is it such an opportune time? I mean, we've been through transition after transition. Professor Sturm let out the secret that I've been in this industry more than 35 years, so yeah, unfortunately, that means I'm an older person, and I've seen these transitions. And, you know, I started with mainframe, and we went through the transition. Of course, mainframes are still there, but we add on significant transitions that we've all been through with microcomputing and the advent of the PC, moving into mobile devices, moving into connected mobile devices, where we just, all of us, have data with us everywhere throughout our day, whether at work or at play. So we've been through all these transitions. So why is the CTO of AMD is going to get up here at Embedded World and he's going to tell you that it's yet another major transition? Well, that's exactly what I'm going to do. And I hope that when we're done over the next almost 1 hour, that you'll agree with me that it's a historic opportunity for this industry. Yes, technology is affecting everything, every vertical, every industry, but embedded is at the heart. Because embedded is where technology seamlessly weaves into our lives. And it's for most of the public, because most people aren't necessarily in high-tech jobs. So for most people, it's actually where their lives meet technology. That's the kind of impact that the embedded industry has on the world. And that's what we're going to do today, is explore a little bit about where machine intelligence, when brought together with devices, when hardware and software meet and provide solutions, how it can affect people's lives. So let's do just that and start off. We're going to look at some emerging applications. And I'll start with a couple. And you know, the really first one I think you won't be surprised with. Let's think about security. Because security is kind of at the foundation of anything that we do with data, right? Because if you want to use any embedded device, you have to know that your data is protected. And so you're already starting to see smart applications around security. The most obvious ones would be a login, authentication. So whether it be the iPhone X, where you look into it, it recognizes you, Windows Hello, you're starting to see many of these type of very rapid machine intelligence inferencing operations so that it rapidly can detect your face, know that we have the proper security. Well, that's a very visible, no pun intended, very visible application of security, but obviously many, many more. And in fact, as you start looking at how security is being used in the network, it's pretty impressive, because what you're seeing now is machine learning being built into the network and security applications such that you can analyze the data, look at the flow of normal operations, and detect very fine anomalies. And so, you know, there's of course the normal malware detection. So you have a known malware with a known signature. But with machine intelligence, you can go far beyond that because it's real time. It's looking at the data as it traverses the network, and it's looking for anomalies and patterns, and it can flag and learn on the fly to where there could in fact be aberrant behavior. And it can be tailored for your application. You could be running a company's IT. You know where your operations are. You know where data should be flowing. And you probably want it flagged to you where there would be anomalies and changes with that flow. So, you know, a simple example of security. And I'll go even further as you look and you can talk about what you need in applications of industrial automation. We'll look at that in more detail. We're going to look at some medical applications. And we're going to look at the edge of the network. Because the data is becoming so immense, it's actually changing where embedded devices can play in that whole food chain of data analysis from the data center to that point device, that whether it be an IoT device or edge of network. And so that's what we're going to explore today. And what I'd like to do is start a little bit by looking at where some of these emerging applications are and give you an example of that. You know, one that I want to talk about is Amazon Go. It's a facility just outside of Seattle, and it's a prototype that Amazon started up. But it's pretty amazing as you look at an example, because you walk in the store, you have an app, Amazon Go app. You walk in the store, and you start grabbing products, foodstuffs, et cetera, off the shelf, put in your cart. It's already recognized you when you walked in. It's recognizing what you're putting in your cart. And when you walk out, there's not the normal checkout. It's recognizing you. It already has all of your contents. You already have your account with Amazon Go. You walk out the door. It's billing your account. So it's almost a little scary, but it works. It works. And it is the admin. It's a prototype. But it shows you how the kind of detection capabilities are there, the sensors, the sensing, the computer vision, and the machine analysis, machine intelligence analysis, to actually fundamental change very basic things like going to the store and buying products. Right? So there really is some pretty fun examples. And when you look at what is driving it from a trend standpoint, it is that data growth, first and foremost. You look at the numbers, and it's projected by 2021, the annual generation of data will hit 3 zettabytes. 3 zettabytes. So that's 1 million exabytes. That's 1 billion terabytes, excuse me, petabytes of information. It's massive. It's hard to even imagine that kind of data generation. And when you think about the trend, it's that that data is coming from all around us. With the advent of 5G, the pipeline to all of those embedded devices goes up significantly. You're going to be getting on the order of 1 gigabit per second, and particularly in an indoor environment, you can leverage some of the almost, you know, millimeter wave kind of connectivity. But what about even outdoors? And when you're going about in applications, sensor devices, might be video, et cetera, that needs that wider pipe of 5G, and you're going to be getting upwards to 1 gigabit per second. So the bandwidth, that pipeline of data to the embedded devices is going up dramatically, right? So it's the generation of the data. It's fed by wide pipelines of connectivity, and that's what drives that need for intelligence at the edge. And data is no good if you can't put it to use. So that's the point. Bring the intelligence to the edge, make that data useful where you are, providing what you need in context so that it can be put to use. And that's where machine intelligence comes in, because you can, like never before, process that massive amount of data and tailor the algorithms to give you a specific output. So if you have data and you can label that data, learn the network, connect it, process it at the edge, leverage those algorithms, it can be a fundamental game changer. And that's the trend. That's what's affecting our industry as a whole, and that's what's driving change so quickly in embedded devices. So let's go explore a little bit about what does that mean for the industry. And I'll tell you, if we can ease development, the projections are this is over a $20 billion semiconductor market in 2021, if we can make it easy to do. And what it is going to take to be able to do that is what I've outlined here, is getting that data to be representative data, getting it to where whatever the application you have, can you get at that data and can you massage it? Can you get it so that it's labeled? Can you get it so you can learn from that data? So that's the first element to enable the advent of and the leveraging of machine learning in our industry. Secondly, is the algorithms themselves, right? Can you really look at those algorithms in such a way that you can leverage the advances of the algorithms, the neural net, matrix math? We'll go into that a little bit later. That's been around for years. How can you leverage it to put it to use? Can you make applications that people can use in a more straightforward way? And are there the proper engines to provide the horsepower to manage and analyze all that data, to do real-time analysis? Those are the areas that we'll take a few minutes and walk through, which are going to be required to make sure that this trend isn't something that we look back on and said could have, should have happened, but when in fact that does happen. It starts right now if, as an industry, we can make these enablers come true. So I'm going to start with data. Let's go on to the next slide. And let me match up here. So look, the amount of data is in fact exploding. And you don't have to look far to know how people are recognizing that, because it's affecting all of the industries. And industries are putting their money on the bet that if they can analyze that data, it will improve their productivity. It will pay off. It will bring that return on investment. You just have to look at GE. He spent $1 billion on putting a number of scientists around analyzing the data they have. Think about what GE is managing and jet engines, turbines, oil discovery. They are applying the engineers to take the massive amount of data they have and be able to drive ROI in their businesses. That's a great use point. Another to think about is Walmart. Walmart in the U.S., they're certainly global, but in the U.S., one of the largest retail outlets, driving over a million transactions a day, And you know what that does? That generates 2.5 petabytes of data a day. And so Walmart has been investing hugely in leveraging their data and bringing that to bear. In fact, they have made a huge investment of Jet that brought a lot of those advanced data sciences into their company. Another example I'll use is Airbus. Airbus with their A380-1000 model put over 10,000 sensors on the wings of this new airplane. 10,000 sensors. And so think about what that's doing. It's a huge airplane. It can seat over 1,000. But it tells you that marriage of sensors and devices of what it takes to take on more ambitious goals like Airbus certainly did in that application. So it comes down to harnessing the data, making it relevant. That's what's going to be one of these key elements. And you've got to bring to bear then the algorithms. And machine learning is not new. It's actually been around since the 50s. But when you think about how it was started, it was really rule-based. Scientists were thinking that the way to really capture the way that all of us think and solve problems would be to write a set of rules that would mimic that thinking process. So pretty straightforward, and actually made some good gains. And so you could apply that rule-based theory, and we started making a lot of gains and started out with handwriting recognition, and it was realized that as you started doing rule-based, it just hit a fundamental wall of accuracy. It just couldn't get over the accuracy barrier to be able to hit a broader set of applications. And so there was a different kind of thinking to bring convolutional neural nets together and to create a set of matrix operations where you would not only go through from a set of data that you have, that you label, so you have a set of data that with a known, let's say, recognition, classification routine. So here's a set of photos. I want to classify them. I go through my forward chain, through my convolutional neural net. I have a set of statistical weights. And did I get it right? No, if I didn't get it right, I loop back in a backward chain and I iterate forward and backward, and the statistical weights that will drive that correct answer of a machine learning application, when you know those statistical weights, that's called inferencing versus the training, which is this forward and backward loop. And that set the stage for what can enable you to bring machine intelligence, machine learning into your embedded applications. Because now that's progressed to very high rates of accuracy. And it's been enabled by advanced engines and devices that we'll talk about a little bit that make it economical to bring these algorithms, convolutional neural nets, deep neural nets. The algorithms are changing every day. There's adversarial networks. It depends on the problem that you're trying to solve, the data that you are analyzing. But in all cases, you're going to run training that's going to take teraflops and teraflops, typically done in the cloud. And when you're done, you have these weights. You can apply them typically in embedded devices at the edge of the network or in a point IoT device. You will apply that learning in a set of inference application. And that needs to be much lower power. It can't be the stuff of what's in the data center. That has to be much lower power, more performance per watt. And when, so that algorithmic development is the second key enabler for this advent of machine intelligence that we can take advantage of. And I talked about application development. Well, of course, first and foremost, if we want broad use of applications, it has to be written in high-level language. We've had for years supercomputers in all of the largest countries, and we've been writing and seeing huge high-performance compute leveraging farms of CPUs and GPUs and the ability to take on the kind of learning tasks I talked about. You know, so why has it not been till now that we've seen this whole advent of applications pouring out? Is it's been the stuff of supercomputers and the big national labs around the world. But what's happened is high-level languages are able to now use frameworks that hide that complexity. So what's a framework doing? When you look at the frameworks that are out there, like Caffe, like TensorFlow, like CNTK, like Onyx, you're going to see there's a number of these frameworks. They're the gasket. They're that layer between that high-level language that you write to the framework that can hide the complexity, because that framework understands those neural nets that you're trying to apply. It's allowing you to, in a very simple way, call them out from that high-level language. It, in turn, calls out the infrastructure that folks like me that are in the component industry, we have to handle that complexity of how math libraries are optimized for the engine, that device that's the computer engine underneath. We have to take care of that, and we have to put the tools and compilers together. So what you now have is an ecosystem that can speed that application development, that can hide the complexity that's been there, which has made, you know, a lot of these high-performance compute applications, the stuff of supercomputer labs, and can bring it to the masses because it's easy. It's easier to do because you can write it high-level language. And the analogy I'll give you is a simple one. Think about smartphones. There was the first attempts, there was smartphones, there was Newton, there was Palm Trio, they were very good. I was an early adopter, I loved it. But there was a limited number of apps, and frankly, the market was pretty limited. What changed? Apple came out with an app store. Made it very easy by putting out tool chains and software that would make it easy to write applications and distribute it. And then we saw a meteoric rise, not only, of course, of iPhone, but the industry, the whole smartphone industry. That's what will happen within my applications, and we're just getting started. But these are the elements that will, in fact, make it easier for this application development. And then you do come to what's near and dear to my heart, and that is the engines. So, you know, what's happened is, you know, Moore's Law has been great. Moore's Law is slowing down. I'll talk about it more later. But more, what you're seeing is the computing that used to be in the data center, we're now able to get into embedded devices. It wasn't long ago that what you can run today in an edge of network was only found in a rack running hundreds of watts in the data center, and now you can run it for dozens of watts and the edge of network, and for a watt or less, usually far less, in an IoT device. So you're seeing this range of engines be able to span from minuscule IoT devices to edge of network to the data center. And it depends on the algorithm, what device you're using. From CPUs and GPUs, easy to program, lots of horsepower you can bring to bear. But once the algorithm might be stable, you might find that you can leverage an FPGA, typically inference applications, leveraging FPGAs and even specialized devices. Today, training's about 75% of this kind of market, typically run CPUs and GPUs, and then the inference applications, 25%, really using all the range of these devices. But you will see that mix shift, because with that ease of application development, I really project that you're going to start seeing a really extreme rise, and the embedded industry will drive it, of those inferencing applications, and therefore the market for devices which have that machine intelligence power in the surroundings. Again, like I said earlier, woven into the fabric around our lives. So let's look today at, you know, if we have these elements and we're poised for that growth, what industries might it drive? Where might we start to see inflection points? The start of what's to come in certain industries is upon us now, right? So the evidence is already there now where we're starting to see these changes. And when you look at what you're seeing today, you can see in medical devices where we've seen huge change. Industrial automation, automotive driving, both driver-assisted and truly self-driving vehicles. And then, of course, smart cities where you're seeing, whether it be surveillance or monitors and sensors, they're helping cities run more efficiently. So we will dive down in some of these examples, and I would like to actually start with medical. And if you look at medical, this is one that should strike all of us very personally, because none of us are immune with ourselves or our family to, of course, diseases which can be terrible and devastating across your own lives or those of lives around you. And, you know, I show on the left side an example of medical imagery. So this is a MRI simulation, and you see it's looking for the detection of an illness, of basically an aberration that shouldn't be there. So how does this play with machine learning? I mean, that's what doctors are trained to do. Absolutely. But doctors can leverage the help because some of the variations are minuscule and need very, very fine resolution. And some of them might be so rare that you'd have to have a massive treasure trove of data in history to even know that that observation represented the indication of a disease. And that's where machine learning comes in. That's what we talked about. If you have that data, you have that history, you massage that data, you brought those algorithms to bear, then you can drive that example, like the medical imagery, to provide that early detection. And in fact, avoid diagnostic errors. How many deaths might be there through no fault of a physician, but simply due to the lack of analysis capability that may result in a misdiagnosis or missing a chance for an early diagnosis and an early intervention? You know, I just give you one example, and that's with brain cancer. There was over 1 million cases of brain cancer that Ancora Technology looked at that, and they said, look, let's go after that. Let's develop an app that can help catch that type of brain cancer. And they've actually developed a personalized radiation. So they can look at an individual, they can analyze the data, tailor that analysis, and drive that early detection and therefore early treatment. So, you know, it's personal, the kind of things it can do. It can affect people's lives. It can affect, our health. It can in fact drive better health care for the population. Right? So it's, to me, I find it an incredibly intriguing application. And so I thought it might be great to start there as we are going to be joined by some of AMD's industry partners to see how they're starting to apply technology in the embedded arena and drive this change. And so what I'd like to do is invite Luca Rossano, Director of Software at ISA OT, up here. ISA OT has been around for over 30 years, driving the manufacturing and commercialization of technology solutions. And it's really one of the leading producers of medical diagnostic tools. And Luca has over 25 years of experience. Like me, he's seen these changes going on in the industry. And I think it will be great to get his perspective. So Luca, please join me, and we look forward to comments that you may have.
Thank you so much, Mark. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay.
Let me grab you this. So Luca, if to get started, if I may, I'd like to just get some thoughts from you on ISA OT, and what are some of the advances that you are seeing? And we just talked about machine intelligence and how it might affect the industry. You're in it. You're living it every day. Please give us some of your thoughts.
Okay, first of all, the greet is for my boss, the CTO, that will be the plan that he will be here, but is a ski accident during the weekend. I'm here to substitute. Okay.
Andre, the CTO of Visiote, had a ski accident, and so thank you very much
for
stepping in.
Second point, compliment for your presentation, but because you got a lot of points that are very impressive for me, and they're because let me explain a while how it works an ultrasound machine. First of all, okay, ESAOTE is a biomedical manufacturer mainly focused on ultrasound equipments and dedicated MRI machine. But keeping back to the ultrasound machine are a real-time machine. The ultrasound works on a lot of huge of data because the raw data, keeping in consideration that is more or less 100 gigabytes per second of data that must be elaborated to compute an image. The image processing must be done in real time because we are working more or less on 30 frames per second. And it's clear that you match with your presentation a lot of points that because our mission is how to get the innovation, to improve the accuracy, and to be let the doctor to have analysis and diagnosis as fast as possible.
Well, it's clearly that you're starting to see an enablement on some of the trends that I've talked about with both hardware enablement and software enablement.
Yes,
so
sure.
Tell us a little bit more on some of the use cases that you see with this type of capability that you're developing.
Yes, about the new era, you mentioned that we are pretty close in a new era, and we are in our machine, we are moving the computational power from a dedicated hardware to software machine. We are moving to a much defined software-defined architecture. And this is the reason why we are looking for partners like AMD in order to have so much power computation available to do that.
Oh, that's great. Do you feel this is one that you've got it covered on your own, or are you looking for collaboration in the industry on some of these applications?
Yes, sure. Yes, it's clear that we need help, and that we try to keep the leader of the market to help us in this mission.
So I know we've really enjoyed our partnership. Obviously, a little bit of a leading question there, because we've been able to partner with ESAOTE, and I think about security. We talk about security
it's one of Skida that speaking about data. We have a lot of quantity of data, but it's clear that specifically in medical context, the security and the privacy protection is a must for a manufacturer as ESAOTE. And we are looking with attention feature functionality from hardware from the hardware components in order to support this security, introducing the as less as possible computational problem on the machine.
And tell me a little bit, we've been very happy to partner with you on the V1000, one of our new Ryzen processors coming out. Congratulations, I hear it's coming in an upcoming product. Can you tell us a little bit about it?
Yes, we launched the final period of the last year, our newer machine, that is my Lab 9 XP, that is the first step of the new generation products in ESAOTE. And for this machine, we have in plan to a new version for the second half of 2018 with a V1000 Ryzen embedded processor on board. And with this new machine, we will have an increasing in the capability of the imaging processing.
Well, that's very exciting. Well, I'll tell you, I think it's pretty clear about how medical applications can affect us, and really a pleasure to hear from you what you all are doing at ESAOTE. And again, our thanks for partnership.
Okay,
with you.
Thank you so much.
Luca, thanks
bye.
Much. So, great example of what I was talking about, and I think what we ought to do is shift gears a little bit, and what I'll do is talk about industrial automation. And, we actually chatted a little bit earlier about, kind of that opportunity of harnessing data, and I gave that example of several companies that are investing very heavily in this area. And certainly another example would be Siemens. Siemens is huge right here. Here we are in the embedded world, right here in Germany. I just heard even earlier today that Siemens is investing just north of Nuremberg here with a big facility. So major, major investments. And they've been in it since the 90s. And just you know, one of the facts I'll share is that, you know, one of the steel operations they have, they've already found tremendous success. They actually hired over 200 engineers and programmers to focus on MI applications. And what they're finding is a significant advancements in productivity. And so the data, there's many, many data points. I pick one and tie it to locally here in the area. But you're reading about it literally every day. And so I think it would be great to, you know, just think about those areas. What does it do as we start bringing that machine learning, start leveraging that that data? What it's going to do is just directly affect efficiency. So yes, robotics have been here for years, but what about when you make those robotics smarter? What about when you bring that real-time data analysis, the kind of same detection capability that we talked about for medical applications? What does that do when you bring it into the factory and you could find defects early? You could drive up efficiency. You can drive up quality. And in fact, you can make safer working conditions because you're reacting real time to the data. So that's the kind of change that can be afoot. And it's pretty exciting. And so I think, again, let's invite up one of our partners, because let's take food inspection, which we rely all on every day. What do you have if you don't have excellent food inspection? And so we'd like to invite up Ricardo Ribalda, who's a product engineering leader at Q Technology. And Ricardo has been working for years on the next generation of industrial cameras. He's an expert in computer vision and leveraging open source. He's been very involved in Linux projects leveraging open source. And so it's been our pleasure to partner with Q Technology. And I want to thank you, Ricardo, for joining us. And we look forward to hearing some thoughts on technology and food inspection.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Mark. It's a great opportunity to be here. So industrial computer vision, let's start from the very, very beginning. And the very, very beginning is 1969. In 1969, the CCD was invented. The CCD was the first way we were able to have to see images using silicon. And it was invented in 1969. And you can see that the industry were holding their breath for this achievement, because just 3 years later, we could see the first module that was using the CCD to look into car brakes, make sure the brakes were properly built. And just 8 years later, the industry explodes. We see tens of machines that are using computer vision. And everyone, all of these installations have one thing in common. They were small pieces of art. We didn't have enough computation power back then. So every single application needed to be completely tailored. And they were not super complicated applications. I mean, don't get me wrong, it's considering the amount of power they were having back then, but they were always looking into artificial stuff. And when you are looking into artificial stuff, you are looking into, you always have a reference point. So let's say we want to look into screws. When we look into a screw, you have a reference screw, and if you take a screw, you take an image of the new screw, you compare it, and if it's not exactly the same, the screw is wrong. You can do the same with PCBs, you can do the same with chips. But when you're looking into potatoes, when you're looking into carrots, when you're looking into natural stuff, there's no such a thing of like a reference potato. There's no such a thing of a reference carrot. So what do you do? Well, you need to use a lot of computation power. And you are not only looking into reference carrots. You're not of course, what you have in the pipeline is going to be most of the time potatoes, but you also want to look into some properties. So for example, in potatoes, we are looking into green spots, we are looking into black spots, we are looking into a scarf, and also you want to make sure you don't sell golf balls, because you know they are not very tasty. And of course, you don't want to sell potato fruits. Potato fruits is the fruit of the potato is super poison. You don't want to kill your clients. They will not buy more potatoes from you if you kill them. So how do you do this? Well, as I said before, you need a lot of computation power, because what you are going to do is do a lot of 3D in order to measure the size of the potatoes, and of course, deep neural networks. You need algorithms that let you generalize what a potato is and continue with that process. We started with potatoes. These potatoes has been our main product for the last years. And we started with this project in 2002. And in order to get the amount, in order to get the right throughput, we can call it potatoes per minute, we needed a lot of DSPs. Not one, not two, we needed tens of DSPs. DSPs is just a fancy word for a chip that can only multiply and carry, and we need tens of them. That was super expensive and difficult to produce. So in 2005, we moved from that platform into an FPGA platform. And I guess you work with them. They are good, they are amazing. You can make any circuit in theory with them, but they are very complicated to process. And also, developing BHDL requires time, requires validation, and yeah, it requires a lot of money. In 2009, we decided to explore different markets, explore different architectures. And before we explore the different markets, we built a new platform where we could have a modular system. So we moved all the computation into the body of our camera, and we took that external FireWire camera and we integrated it in our system, but like a separate module. And thanks to that, it was a new step in, it was a step in the right direction. But before we move forward, you need to look into this trend. 2002, 2005, 2009, it's like, what, 4 years per development cycle. And also every single of these products were exactly like the products they were in the 80s. They were super custom made. These things were nothing more than a potato counter. But in 2012, everything changed for us. We decided to use AMD APUs, and that opened the market for us. That was a completely change in direction. That was an increase in quality for us, because right now we can leverage from a huge ecosystem of libraries and libraries and companies that can help us. So for example, in terms of OS, we can get the help from Mentor Embedded Linux for doing the OS. So we don't need to take care of security and things like that. And when we want to take care of computer vision, we can use OpenCV. When we want to use neural networks, we can use TensorFlow, we can use PyTorch. There's a huge amount of work that we can leverage from. And also we have been working very close with the open source community. We have been upstreaming our work, and thanks to that we can access all the software, all the hardware from our camera, from Video for Linux, which is a great thing. And right now we are not anymore in front of a system that is custom. We're not in front of just a potato machine, just a potato counter machine. Now we can produce new products based on this platform. And these products are not made in 4 years. They are not made in 2 years. They are made in 3 months. They are made in 2 weeks. And this has been one of the last products we have built into this platform. Yes, they are in the food industry, because that's where we have our clients. That's the industry we know. But we are also entering other markets, like, for example, research and development. We have been working very close by with Carlsberg. And in the research and development lab, they're very interested in, you know, making sure their beer doesn't have particles, their beer doesn't have have the right amount of particles. And up to some months ago, the way they were doing it was with an expert taking a beer and putting it in front of light. And now they have a machine which can objectively figure out how many particles there's in their beer. Carlsberg, very nicely, they have allowed us to bring the instrument to the embedded world, and if you want to see it, you can see in the booth in that place. And yeah, what is the future? So right now, If you remember at the beginning, I was talking about a new order of magnitude of complexity when we move from artificial stuff into natural stuff. Now we are also in the middle of a new order of magnitude change. Hyperspectral imaging is becoming super affordable. Hyperspectral imaging is when you have images that doesn't have one, two, or three colors. They have tens or hundreds of colors. You can use it for material analysis. You can use it for finding bacteria. You can use it for doing science. You can do it for analyzing the ground. And the problem with these images is, first of all, you have much more colors. You have much more images. It's not anymore an image. It's a cuboid of images. And you need a lot of computing power. And the other problem you have is that your brain is not used to work with more than three colors. So we need automatic algorithms that can look into this data and trying to find patterns when our brain cannot. At the beginning, I was saying that in the 1980s, they were looking for an architecture that was could do generic computer vision. I think we are in the right track. I think we have a machine that can be used for doing generic computer vision. I think AMD will still help, will continue helping us, giving us more throughput, so we don't need to take care anymore of fine-tuning our applications. And they will give us better drivers so we can use all this performance from the GPU. And we, Q Technology, will make sure that we can, all that tremendous performance, we can pack it in a nice way so our clients can make use of it. And I think I already well beyond my time, because I get excited when I speak of potatoes. So thank you so much for your time, and thank you, Mark. Thank you.
Thank you. Ricardo, thank you so much. Well, I'll tell you, first off, on your ask, we're definitely going to be there driving generation after generation, giving you more performance, more throughput at lower power. That's what we're, and the industry, for that matter, here to do. So that's the inexorable pace. But I think there's a real lesson in a couple of the comments that Ricardo gave us, and that is, look at the speed at which Q Technology and Ricardo and team have increased their product delivery. So they invested in computer vision, a set of embedded machine intelligence, attacked it on an application like potatoes, a food inspection, and then look at how rapidly they're going after other applications. And I think in our embedded industry, I think that's a very inspirational, seeing that story. And it tells you about the speed of product development going forward. Because things are changing, development is moving more rapidly, and you know the advent of these applications is changing fundamentally how the network is going to be deployed. And we can start off looking at, really the edge of network, a theme that I talked about earlier. We're going to dive into that a little bit, because we are seeing this shift of what was always done in the cloud out to the edge. And again, we talked about that change, but let's dive in a little bit more. Cisco, I think, originally coined the term fog computing of this whole trend, and started making investments early. And what they've also, you'll see, is talked about, of course we have the wide area networks and the local area networks, but there's actually a neighborhood area network where you're having to attack for edge computing, look at how you can take the heavy lifting that used to be in the cloud and manage that massive amount of data. We talked about it earlier. And what you see here, from this traditional sense, is that you're going to see the traditional types of computing, it's not going away. So you're still having, the massive data centers. Traditional workloads of data centers aren't changing. All the bank processing, data transaction, web serving, all of that's not going away. This is additive. This is an additive market when you took at that learning trend that I talked about. And when you add to it the massive amount of IoT data, it can't all be processed by that small IoT device. That's where you're seeing the edge analytics. That's where you're seeing these applications that are having to run inferencing. They're having to run it not at the hundreds of watts that you can on a server rack, but at dozens of watts in an inferencing application at the edge of the network. And, you know, I think it's probably a great time to look at an application here, and that is from one of our customers, and one of our, one of our partners, and that is Scott Morrison. I'd like to hear a little bit from Scott about how Mentor Graphics is taking on this challenge of managing all of this data, and what are they finding are tools that can accelerate the development of embedded applications. And who better to hear from than Mentor? Mentor is actually the only EDA company that has a software embedded division. They've been at this for years, trying to enable this kind of solution. It's now a Siemens business, which has given them even more scale and growth. And Scott, like me, is an industry veteran. You know, he's been around over 30 years. He's seen those transitions. And I think it will be excellent to hear from Scott a little bit about what Mentor is doing and how they're enabling the transition of machine intelligence into edge applications. So Scott, please join me on stage. Let's give a big round of welcome to Scott Morrison.
Hey, Mark.
Scott, thanks for joining us here. And you know, as GM of the Platform Solutions Division, you've been tackling these problems. Probably there's not a trend I walk through here that you haven't been taking on, that you haven't been attacking and Mentor. And I think you know, what would be great, I think, for our audience here in Embedded World is to just get some of your thoughts. And you know, I know you guys have been working, you know, starting with even face detection and how do you, you know, that what a great application of machine learning at the edge. Maybe we get one, some of your thoughts on the trends, the inflections we're at, and then maybe jump into an application like that and understand how Mentor is actually enabling this edge and of network analysis to speed embedded applications.
Sure, yeah, sounds great. So I just happen to have brought a video along. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show an example, just a short video of an application, and then I'll talk a little bit about the software architecture that enables that, and we get into a little bit more detail about other industrial applications. So if we can cue the video. So this is not a very sort of realistic. This is obviously people who are just showing the capabilities of the system. And you can see as each of them like turns towards the camera, you see a purple box appear. And what that is that we have a TensorFlow-based recognition algorithm running on the edge on a Ryzen embedded V1000. And what it does is detect the face, and then there's a classification that is done after the initial detection that basically looks at the cropped image and does basically a probabilistic calculation of the mood of the person, and it can also do things like age estimation and other types of demographic data can be derived from this picture. And of course, this can be used in a crowded marketplace or an airport or something like this. This is a very trivial example. And if you come by the AMD booth, much like Ricardo was saying, there's an example of this running there. So you can interact with the system and try to test it and stress it a little bit more. If we look at the way this is actually done, it's kind of an interesting architecture. It starts with, of course, a camera here and uploading 30 frames per second to the Ryzen V1000, which is this high-powered edge device that we're using with our customers and partners. And that's where the initial, as I said, TensorFlow-based neural network is done for the object recognition, the facial recognition. And then what it does is it actually takes the cropped image of each face that it finds in the screen, and it uploads it to the cloud for classification. And that's where that mood analysis and other types of information is derived from the still images. And then those labels and display come back down to the Ryzen processor. And then in this case, we have a localized display. It could be a monitoring system in the area where the camera is deployed. And so an operator can see the classification information for the people in that particular area. And the other thing that we're doing is we're taking the data that's available in the cloud, and we're doing an analytics portal that can also be accessed from a mobile device. And that shows you how the information in terms of the number of people, maybe the recurrence of the same people coming into the scene, the mood shifts during the course of the day, perhaps other types of information can be archived and made available on an analytics portal. So that's the overall architecture, and it's just an example of what we can do with the runtime components that we're pulling together. and we can talk about other examples in industrial, if you'd like.
Great. Well, I've got a couple of questions. It's exciting to see, Scott, what you're doing here. And, you know, one of the questions I have is about the industry. I mean, what are you seeing as you bring out this kind of capability? You know, is the industry, is it ready? Do we have the right enablement? Where are we in this very exciting advent of capability?
Yeah, it is. There's really a transition happening, as you mentioned earlier, and it's really on, I think, the front of that meteoric rise that you talked about. Some of the capabilities that we're seeing for the application of ML industrial are really retrofitting, replacing systems that have already been out there, but with a higher level of capability and refinement. So, for instance, if you look at this particular example, of course, cameras and vision systems are starting to be more widely deployed in industrial, but that's kind of the leading edge right now, I would say. But if you look at more classical industrial applications, there's really this crush of data that's available. And they've been very limited in the past by the processing power, the deployed compute power in the industrial automation system for how much analysis you can do there. But that's really been exploded or opened up with the advent of really, really powerful edge-based processing engines like the Ryzen V1000. So if you look at a classical example, there might be a few hundred or a few thousand sensors. Or in some of the more advanced process control applications, one with really large scale, you might get tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands. And so that's just, and once again, an amazing amount of data. So it may not be vision, but we're seeing people with just the large sensor integration and sensor fusion and processing that, once again, they need that really significant edge computing capability that the Ryzen enables.
Excellent. Well, we appreciate your partnership on Ryzen V1000. And you mentioned real time. So are you seeing, you know, is that kind of processing capability helping you in that real time processing?
It really does. I mean, if you look at this architecture, one of the things that's really, really useful about it is that with the edge computing doing the initial object detection or other types of local processing, you get that very fast response. And if you have a data lag to the cloud or even lose the connection to the cloud, you get a certain amount of real time analysis that's immediately there for the operator. So I think there's that nice blend of being able to do that real-time but still fairly intense processing, yeah, but then leveraging the full capability of a data center cloud-based computational backend.
Excellent. Well, Scott, thanks very much for what you are doing, what Mentor is doing, and really helping this industry, embedded industry, speed applications to market.
Well,
thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you very much. Yes.
Okay, well, what I'd like to do is I'm going to wrap by jumping to my last example, and that's automotive. And automotive, I think, is a super example of bringing this all together in terms of the type of processing power that's moving out to the edge, because automotive is becoming a data center application on wheels. That's the kind of processing power that's moving into automotive. And, you know, Ford has already said that they're going to need 25 gigabytes per hour of data that's going to be coming in and out of their vehicles because they're surrounded by LIDARs and radars and sensors. It comes into a sensor fusion. It pulls it all together, and it needs to be analyzed by the kind of CPUs and GPUs that are data center class. And so it's really a great example. And if you just look at what you see that's coming here around the corner, is you're already seeing driver-assisted. It's on the road today with everyone driving towards a certification of the industry by, you know, within the next couple years of a level 4 capability. So that's, you know, a very, I'll say, driver-free mode, but not driverless, not a full driverless. That's level 5. And that's predicted to be in the next 10 years. And so you're seeing very highly automated driving. You're seeing these sensors and the computing capability being already invested. Right here in Germany, there's a heart of a tremendous amount of development going on in this area. And the growth is phenomenal, with really over 20% compounded growth rate now through 2025. So it's a very, very steep slope. And it's heavily leveraging every trend of the technology that we went through here today. And so with that, I want to just share a little bit of information about what AMD is doing and our strategy to attack this. And again, we talked earlier about engines. We do the GPU and CPU engines, which we think will speed this transformation. We just announced our Radeon Vega 7 nanometer. So it will be sampling later this year. It's in the newest technology node, 7-nanometer technology node. And what it's going to do is really optimize for compute applications. Compute applications like machine learning training in the cloud, right into those automotive applications, which are not only running those inference applications that you've already trained, but they're having to do hybrid training and learning on the fly. They're having to analyze real time the new situations, the new data that might change as the environment changes, or when you go offline, when you're not connected. And so, you know, these markets are driving this kind of capability, and that's just the start with what we see where Radeon can go, because we've expanded our line to cover across what we have in terms of Ryzen, where we've taken Ryzen and from desktop commercial applications into embedded. You heard about the V1000, where we'll talk about in just a minute, right through EPYC, that we move in to the embedded applications with that data center horsepower. So EPYC is a 32-core processor, 64 threads, and what we designed it for is the most demanding of data analysis applications. So with a massive amount of memory, up to 32 megabyte of L3 cache, over 3 gigahertz, 4 independent memory channels, and 64 lanes of connectivity on a single socket for embedded applications, including, with the system on a chip, bringing all the connectivity you need. So bringing the connectivity of 10 gigabyte Ethernet and the security capability. Moving into the embedded applications where you need low power. You heard about that V1000 from the guests we invited. So one silicon with Vega GPU and Zen CPU cores, all on one silicon. And being able to go from just a few watts to up to 50 watts of applications. Again, system on a chip, bringing at low power these applications. And that's the trend. Providers like AMD have to be able to provide from hundreds of watts to dozens of watts, and there'll be those that will serve those IoT devices, which are milliwatts. So that's what we're out with our products, and we are incredibly excited in terms of what we see and the opportunity of software, because what we've done is we've invested in an open architecture to do that enablement. And so if we go to the next slide, I'll describe to you what we announced in January, our Radeon Open Compute ecosystem, where I told you earlier that it's up onto the suppliers to provide that enablement that translate from high-level languages and the frameworks into the device specifics. And so that's exactly what we've done. And we've done it in such a way that it's not only open, so we put all that out there. You can port if you've written in CUDA, so you've already optimized a set of applications in CUDA, port it right over using our HIP tool onto Radeon, or compile it back to any other source target that you want. So we've enabled that transition. And from an open standpoint, what we've done is we've not only provided the base driver stack, but the whole stack. We have put out there on gpuopen.com, so it's out in GitHub repositories, and that's our commitment. We think that will speed growth, particularly in embedded. Embedded is a Linux-dominated environment. It's an open source dominated development environment, and that's exactly what we're targeting, is to bring not just a smaller set of programmers and developers and a proprietary set, but democratize access to these machine learning applications by opening up the whole enablement stack. So this is very personal to us at AMD. We're very excited about helping accelerate this whole change, this whole dramatic transition that we see the industry going through. And that leads us to where we are today. It is an opportunity for transition. If we seize it, if we drive those smart devices across the industry, if we can harness the data, can massage that data and harness it and power it by high-performance solutions and open software, we will dramatically make the future intelligent, make all those IDC projections you saw earlier actually underestimate what this industry can achieve in terms of applications. And so what I'd like to do is wrap with really a challenge to you, because I have to say this in my 35-plus years, is the most excited I've ever been in terms of the opportunity in front of us. And I'd like you to think about your industry, whether you're in a development, whether you're various verticals that you're after. Think about the data that you have. What do you have access to? How can you grab it? How can you drive your business plan to take advantage of it? How can you disrupt the markets you're serving rather than be disrupted? That's the opportunity for you. That's the opportunity for the industry. And that's what we in AMD are focused and ready to partner with you on. Thank you so much for having me with you here today. And have a great conference.
Many thanks, Mark, for this outstanding speech. I'm really impressed about it, and many, many thanks again also to the other speakers here in the audience. Thank you so much for coming and for joining and for helping our embedded world to make a greater place.
Dr. Stern, thanks for having me. Thank you all.
Thank you. Bye. Thanks a lot.